Welcome to this week's edition of the Career Fitness Tips. This week we're going to be taking a look at the anatomy of a resume. If you've been following us all along, we're taking segments of resumes and we're breaking them up so that we can go through those together. I'm showing you clips from a live broadcast that I did a few weeks ago with a bunch of job seekers in Germantown. And this week we're going to talk about resume anatomy. What are the different parts of the resume and how do I put them all together? So join me now for this week's edition of the Career Fitness Tips.
The anatomy of the resume now. We need to talk about that. This is on page 30. Okay. To help us with the anatomy of the resume, just keep a thumb in page 28. On page 30. Did I say 30? My book's falling apart. Keep a thumb in page 30, but then let's go back to bend over on page 26. Okay, we'll use Ben's resume as our guidebook for the anatomy. All right, here's the pieces of the resume. First part is the header. The header is your name and contact information. I know there are some folks that don't want to put address on there, and I've seen more and more resumes without address on there, but you got to have the email and phone number. And again, professional is the key here. Underneath that is an objective statement. Now, somebody asked me this earlier. The objective statement is an optional item. The objective statement is not where you talk about, experienced project manager seeking company with upwardly mobile positions for walks on the beach and movies. Like those personal ads you read in the Gazette, some of you read in the Gazette. The objective statement is designed for one purpose only, and that is to get it in the right stack. I used to work at Holy Cross Hospital in the HR department, and you never seen so many resumes as you would on a Monday morning that would come in the fax machine. And our job was to sort those things out. Objective statements that were very brief and to the point were very helpful. So Bendover is looking for a security management position at XYZ Corporation. That narrows it down. At Holy Cross, we would say looking for an upwardly mobile position with a cutting edge hospital. Okay, we have 65 positions. Which one do you want? Then you got to look through it. Most of the time, you don't take the time to do it. Some would say looking for a nursing position. Okay, we have 30. Gee, I hope you like children, because guess where you're working? We needed pediatric nurses right now. Then there were some that says, looking for a nurse in the PACU, position 45C, the position number. We knew exactly what they wanted. When you go to a job fair, go online, find out the companies that are going to be there, go to the company's website, look at the company's job listings, find the one you want, tailor a resume to that listing, put an objective statement with that job number in it, and you hand it to that recruiter. Guess what you get in return? You get their personal card. One of my clients did that last week at the job fair, came up with 5 personal cards. Okay, that's a win. So the objective is optional. If you don't know, you could leave it blank. But as much as possible, I would encourage you. This helps guide it to the right person. Now, next thing is a summary of qualifications. Summary of qualifications is some of the top things that you bring. Now, let's just say that I was a record producer and my boss said, Malcolm, you need to put together a catalog. We need a greatest hits package of AC/DC. How many CDs would that take? 12. I'd say at least 12. One of the finest bands ever. Some of you are like, who's AC/DC? They're like, aren't they satanic? All right, here's the deal. Whatever you say, have they been making music a long time? Since the 70s. So I say, good, no problem. And he says, wait a minute. We're marketing this to women aged 45 to 55. Okay, how many CDs are we looking at now? Maybe one with like 5 songs on it, right? We're making that collection for a specific audience. Some of you, if I said give me your greatest hits, you give me a whole page. But I'm looking for the greatest hits for that open position. So go to the job posting, look under the job requirements, find the ones that you meet or exceed, and then you would write that as your greatest hits. That's what a summary of quals is. It's your greatest hits. So I would say no more than 5 to 7. And these need to line up with what the company is looking for. That, keep in mind, when someone reads your resume, they start at the name, they work their way down. You want to tease their eyes all the way down the page. So they like you, they like the email, oh, perfect fit, we got this position open. Then they fall in love with you here. Then everything underneath that builds. Your employment history builds on that. So we write it so that they're intrigued going down. We have to build it from the bottom going up. That's how you put these things together. If that's the case, do you get the feeling it's going to take you longer than about 5 minutes to build a resume? A good, tailored, targeted resume should take you a couple of hours minimum, because you're going to go through that job posting with a microscope. And everything that's there, you want to show how you meet or exceed it. When you told me you were going to give me 100%, this is what I'm talking about. The average person has one resume they like the look of. They send it to everything. That's not going to get anything. We're talking about one resume for one job. That takes a lot of work. But if you're serious about this process, that's what we need to do. And then, of course, the employment history should show where you worked and when, and then what you did, and then your education and training. Now, for education and training, depending on the position, you would adjust it. A couple people talked to me about talking about careers they wanted to go to. In some cases, your academic history may be important, so you might put it right up underneath your summary of qualifications. Or you could put it at the bottom of your work history. Dates, it doesn't really matter here. If you got your degree back in 1970, don't put the date on there, okay? If you got your degree last year, don't put the date on there. Unless it's certain fields, like for example, you got a master's degree in Web 2.0 technology. If you just graduated, would you want to put the date on there?
Yes.
When I read a marketing book now, the first thing I do is open up the cover and I look for the date of publication. If it's anything older than 2007, I put it back on the shelf. It's all, it might as well be a scroll, right? So we want to make sure that we are current with the things that need to be current. If you are within 6 to 9 months of your degree, you could put estimated graduation date June of 2009. If you put, you know, well, I graduate pretty soon, estimated graduation date June of 2012, what are you basically saying? Besides, you're stupid, right? You're not going to have your degree for a long time. So seriously, this is where you have to really look at your experience. This is why it takes so long to do it. That's the anatomy of the resume. So we need to make sure it's tailored and targeted. Now,
I hope you enjoyed this week's edition of Career Fitness Tips with me, Malcolm Munro, the Career Fitness Coach. You know, if you really take time to apply the principles you just heard, you'll make a huge difference in the way you do business both at home and at work. So make sure you do that this week. Take the tip and put it to work. If you've got more questions about that, why don't you just email me directly? You can reach me at coach@emailthecoach.com or check me out online on www.careerfitnesscoach.com. Have a great week, and I'll see you next week on Career Fitness Tips.